Hello everyone, my name is Abhishek Buxi. I am Assistant Professor, Department of Zoology, Mahatma Gandhi Government Arts College, Mahe, Union Territory of Puducherry, India. Today we will discuss regarding the excretory system of rabbit, that is Oryctolagus cuniculus. Rabbit, although it is distributed throughout the globe, it is cosmopolitan. However, this species is not an endemic species, or it is not naturally distributed throughout the globe. It was confined to the European and some of the parts of the America. However, in the past, humans traveled and took rabbit throughout the globe. Now it is widely distributed and it is available throughout the globe, both domesticated as well as in the wild form. So today we will focus on the excretory system of rabbit. Rabbit belongs to class Mammalia, the most evolved higher vertebrate of the phylum Chordata. Now, before starting the description and the details of the excretory system of rabbit, let's discuss what we mean by the excretion. There are multiple physiological processes which every living organism, especially animals, they carry out in order to remain alive. All these processes are known as physiological processes. Those processes which include nutrition, that is intake of food and their processing as well as their utilization within the body, respiration, that is breathing, inhalation of the oxygen and exhalation of the carbon dioxide, blood circulation, which includes pumping and distribution of the different material which is present within the blood, neuronal system or nervous system, that is the management, endocrine system. Similarly, there is a separate functional organ system known as excretory system in higher organisms. The function of excretory system is to remove all the metabolic waste from the body. Now, what is metabolism? A living organism always carry out multiple processes throughout its life. These processes at the cellular level known as metabolic processes. Metabolism includes both catabolic as well as anabolic process. That means building up and the breaking down of the molecules. The sum total of these processes are together known as the metabolic processes. In the process of metabolism, every cell generates some of the metabolic waste. These are known as metabolic waste material, or what we call as the remnant materials, which is of no use. These materials, the waste materials, if they get accumulated either inside the cell or outside the cell within the living organisms, they become toxic. This means that none of the living organisms, none of the animals can tolerate a higher concentration of these metabolic waste material. Most of these metabolic waste materials are nitrogenous waste, such as urea, uric acid, ammonia, etc. These metabolic waste also includes the excessive amount of the salts, ions or water which are intaken by the individual animal. The purpose of excretory system is to filter out these toxic metabolic waste from the body system and remove it from the body in order to detoxify and maintain the homeostatic balance of the animal. So, excretory system has evolved in order to carry out this particular function. In the primitive animals, the excretory system is not very well organized, but as the evolution took place, slowly the higher animals have very well defined and organized structure. Rabbit, being a mammal, being one of the highest evolved animal, has a very well defined and systematically organized excretory system in order to remove all its metabolic waste which it generates during its metabolic processes. Rabbit is one of the favorite mammalian model system which are used and utilized both for the illustration, lab purpose, and as well as a model animal to teach mammalian physiological system. Rabbits are also utilized even for the clinical trial of all the pharmacy and the medicines, vaccines which are generated and prepared for the human purpose. The reason behind all these affiliation or affection for the rabbit is because of its similarity in the anatomy and physiological system with that of the human. The same is applicable even for the excretory system of rabbit. The excretory system of rabbit is very similar with that of the human. Today, in this lecture, we will focus on the anatomical structural organization of excretory system of rabbit. So this system is generally responsible for the elimination of metabolic waste products, nitrogenous waste products in the form of urea. So all the mammals, they are ureotelic. They are primarily removing their nitrogenous waste in the form of urea. However, trace amount of uric acid and ammonia is also present in their excretory product, that is in urine. Urine also comprises the excess amount of the salt and water which are present in the body. Let's discuss the anatomical structure of the excretory system of rabbit. The organ of excretion in rabbit comprises a pair of kidneys, a pair of tubular structures known as ureters, and a singular collecting bag known as urinary bladder. Kidneys are the primary and the main organ of excretion in every higher organism, including rabbit. In case of rabbit, the kidneys, the pair of kidneys which rabbits have, they are metanephric in nature. Nephrons are the units of filtration present in the kidney. They have evolved from the pronephric to the mesonephric to highly specialized structure with the filtration process known as metanephric. In case of rabbit, their nephrons are metanephric in nature. Externally, the kidneys are bean shaped, dark red in color. They are paired structures which are attached to the dorsal abdominal wall of the coelom in the rabbit, one on the either side of the vertebral column, that is on the one on the left hand side, one on the right hand side. The position of the right kidney is situated somewhat anterior than the left one. The reason is presence of liver on the right hand side. The majority of the liver is present in its right lobe, and due to the presence of liver just above the kidney, the right kidney is somewhat positioned anterior than the left one. Each kidney is ventrally, from the lower side, it is covered by a peritoneum, the thin membranous like structure. The outer side of the kidney is oval and convex, whereas on the inner side of each kidney, there is a notch, there is a depression known as hilum or the hilus. Actually, the hilum is the site for the entry of renal artery. This is the same site from where the renal vein as well as the ureter of both the kidneys originates. On the next slide, I'll show you the diagram of the kidney. It will make it more clear. A renal artery enters the kidney at hilus, and a renal vein comes out of it through the same position, that is the hilus. Internally, the kidney is divided into layers. So if you'll see the diagram, it will become more evidently clear to you. So if you see the external most layer, which you can see in this diagram, see this one, this external, the outermost layer is known as the capsule. The capsule is made up of fibrous connective tissue. It is basically the protective outer covering of the kidney, which is then followed by a light colored layer, which is the outer layer of the kidney, that is known as the cortex, followed by the thick muscular middle layer, that is known as medulla. The medulla is divided into multiple triangular shape structure. This is known as the renal pyramids, but this structure is not common, or this is not the same in every mammalian species. In case of human and in case of rabbit, the medulla is divided into these renal pyramids. However, in case of lower animals or lower mammals, the medulla is singular and united. And then we have these medulla are having the tube-like structure, which are known as the calyces. The calyces then unite to form the middle central collecting structure, that is known as the pelvis. And then this pelvis ends or terminates into the ureter, which originates from the hilus. This entire part is known as the hilus. You can see this portion. This is the hilus from which the ureter is originating. It is the same location where a renal artery enters inside the kidney to supply blood, and as well as a renal vein originates out from it. The gap here is known as the renal sinuses. Now, there is a, if you pay close attention, the cortex has entered inside the medullary layer as well. And in fact, it is the cortex which are dividing the renal pyramids into separate structures. These dividing wall of the cortex, which is embedded in between the two renal pyramids, they are known as column of Bertini, after the name of the scientist who have discovered it, Mr. Bertini. So these are the different structural details of a mammalian kidney. So basically, the external most layer is what we call as the cortex, which is beneath the capsule. It is the homogeneous light colored structure, which is followed by the medulla. It is the inner region of the kidney, which is dark in color, which is followed by the pelvis. It is a large funnel shaped space in the center of the kidney, which moves towards the hilus. The urine is collected in the pelvis from all the different filtration unit. And then that urine through the ureter is drained off and is collected in the urinary bladder from both the kidneys. The renal pyramids in the rabbit and man, it is divided into multiple lobes, what is known as renal pyramids. And as I mentioned, the cortical portion, which is present or embedded in between the two renal pyramids, they are known as the renal columns of Bertini. In rat, the conical pyramid is single and it is not divided into multiple renal pyramids. The pyramids are projected into the pelvis. The kidney is formed of a mass of fine, long, convoluted tubules, what is known as the uriniferous tubules, or more commonly and more popularly, they are referred as nephrons. These nephrons are the filtration unit of kidneys, through which the blood of mammals or that animal get filtered into a purified blood. All the excretory material which are present in the blood, every tissue, every cell of the body, they remove their excretory material outside their plasma membrane, which are then deposited into the tissue fluid. From the tissue fluid, those excretory material, by the process of diffusion, enters into the blood, and then the blood carries those excretory material into the kidneys. Within the kidney, that blood enters into individual filtration unit. These filtration units are known as uriniferous tubules or nephrons. It is the nephron which actually carries out the process of blood filtration in order to excrete, in order to remove the metabolic waste from the blood of animal. So these uniferous tubules or nephrons, they are embedded in connective tissue. These connective tissue are highly rich in blood and lymph vessels. There are supplies of nerves and smooth muscle fibers to support them. Each uriniferous tubule is in turn can be divided into two major functional parts. The one part where the actual process of filtration takes place, known as Malthusian capsule, and the second part in which the filtrate is processed and finally converted into urine. That second part is known as convoluted duct. The Malthusian capsule can be further subdivided into two parts. The external cup-like material which collects the filtrate, known as the Bowman's capsule, which are located all the nephrons which are present in a kidney. The Bowman's capsule of those nephrons are located in the cortex of the kidney, and it is followed. The Bowman's capsule has a dense, multiple, rich network of capillaries within it. That tuft of blood capillaries is known as glomerulus. So together, Bowman's capsule and glomerulus, they form Malthusian capsule. The Bowman's capsule enclosing the glomerulus is collectively known as the Malthusian capsule, or it is also referred as a renal capsule. Renal is a Latin word for the kidney. The second part of a nephron is the convoluted tube, which originates from the base of Bowman's capsule and which further runs deep inside the medulla of the kidney. This particular convoluted tubule can be further subdivided into three different parts. The first initial part, which is connected to the Bowman's capsule, is known as proximal convoluted tubule, PCT. Finally, when it gets embedded in the medulla, the diameter of the PCT reduces much and it forms a thin, narrow tubular structure which is J-shaped or U-shaped in nature, known as loop of Henle or Henle's loop, after the name of the scientist who discovered it, Henle. Then this tubular structure folds back and moves upward into the cortex again. And when just before entering into the cortex, the diameter of this convoluted tubule again increases to form the distal convoluted tubule. So a nephron is made up of two parts, Malthusian capsule and convoluted tubule. Malthusian capsule has two parts, Bowman's capsule and glomerulus, whereas the convoluted tubule is divided into three regions, PCT, Henle's loop, and DCT. This is a diagrammatic representation of a mammalian nephron. If you pay close attention, here you can see. This is a sectional part of the Malthusian capsule, which is cut open. The Bowman's capsule portion has been cut open in order to expose the dense glomerular capillary network. The blood vessel which brings blood inside the glomerular capillary network is known as afferent arteriole, whereas the blood vessel which takes or collects the blood out of the glomerulus is known as the efferent arteriole. This part is known as the proximal convoluted tubule, which is close to the Bowman's capsule, and slowly it goes down. That is the descending loop of Henle, and this is the ascending loop of Henle, the thin narrow tubular structure. And once it enters, it is about to enter the cortical portion, it again widens and becomes the distal convoluted tubule. The proximal convoluted tubule starts from the Bowman's capsule and makes a few coils, as you can see in the diagram. in the cortex and then proceeds downward as descending limb in the medulla to form a thin loop of Henle. It again proceeds towards the cortex as ascending limb and forms a few coils in the cortex called the distal convoluted tubule. Finally, the distal convoluted tubule joins with one of the larger structure that is known as collecting duct. The collecting tubule unites all the collecting tubules, unites together and pour the collected filtrate, the processed collected filtrate into the pelvis of kidney. The collecting duct, there are, in case of human kidneys, on an average, an adult human kidney contains 1 million nephrons. However, the number of nephrons present in the rabbit kidney has not been given, or it has not been yet studied, but the numbers are enormously large. All these nephrons, they are connected to the multiple collecting ducts. Each collecting duct is connected with multiple nephrons. If you look at the diagram, these all openings, they are representing the joining part of the distal convoluted tubules of different nephrons. So one collecting tubule or one collecting duct is connected with multiple nephrons, and then all these collecting tubules pour the processed urine into the pelvis. The wall of tubule is made up of cuboidal epithelial cells, which are ciliated. So the entire convoluted tubule, which comprises PCT, loop of Henle, DCT, as these all wall, they are made up of the cuboidal epithelial cells, where the inner layer of these cells, which are opening in the lumen, in the inside of the tubular portions, they are ciliated, and it is because of these ciliary structures, they are able to either diffuse the material in the filtrate, or they are capable to remove the required material from the filtrate to the blood. However, the epithelial cell layer of the Bowman's capsule is made up of flat squamous epithelial cells, which enables Bowman's capsule to carry out the process of blood filtration very efficiently. Let's talk about the blood supply of the kidney. In case of kidney, there are two major blood vessels which are present in the kidney. The one which carries blood inside the kidney, that is known as the renal artery, and the one which brings blood out of the kidney, that is known as renal vein. Once inside the kidney, the renal artery divides into multiple small branches, and then it redivides and redivides to finally form hundreds and thousands of arterioles. Each arteriole, each renal arteriole, then enters into separate nephrons to form capillary network known as glomerulus. Now, here one important aspect is that usually in the different parts of the body, in the different tissues of the body, when an arteriole divides and it forms the capillary network, then the respiratory gaseous exchange and all the other material exchange takes place, and oxygen is taken up by the tissues, whereas carbon dioxide is diffused inside the blood. So by the time the blood passes through the capillaries, it becomes from oxygenated to deoxygenated. However, in some particular locations of a mammalian body, there are certain capillary networks where this respiratory gaseous exchange does not take place. That means the blood capillaries are originating from the arteriole and they are terminating also in the form of an arteriole. There is no respiratory gaseous exchange take place. Such structure, or it may be the capillaries are originating from the venule and it is also terminating to a particular venule. Such capillary networks are known as blood capillary portal system. In case of kidney, glomerulus is one such portal system, which is known as renal portal system. As you can see in the diagram, the blood vessel which is bringing the blood inside the glomerulus is afferent arteriole, whereas the blood vessel which is taking blood outside the glomerulus is efferent arteriole. Both are arteriole. So afferent arteriole enter inside the glomerulus, Bowman's capsule divided into glomerulus capillary network. Again, these capillaries joins to form the efferent arteriole. There is no respiratory gaseous exchange. However, when the same efferent arteriole further moves and comes near the proximal convoluted tubule, it further and again divides into the fine capillary network, and this time the respiratory gaseous exchange takes place like in any other part of the body. And subsequently, when these capillaries rejoins, they forms venule, which further joins to the renal vein. So basically, each arteriole enters a Bowman's capsule as an afferent arteriole, which divides into multiple capillaries to form the glomerulus, and then an efferent arteriole emerges from the glomerulus, again divides into the capillaries around the convoluted tubule to distribute the blood in the remaining part of the tubule. These capillaries unite together to form a venule, and a number of such venules unite together to form a renal vein, which comes out of the kidney from the hilus. The diameter of afferent arteriole is larger than the efferent arteriole. This is a very important point. It is because of this difference in the diameter, the pressure inside the glomerular capillaries are enormously high, and it is because of this high pressure, the blood which is present in the glomerulus, they filter out all the waste material inside, along with many even useful material that we'll discuss during the process of excretion into the Bowman's capsule. So it is basically, it is because of the high blood pressure in the glomerular capillaries, the filtration, the ultrafiltration of the nephrons is possible. Branches of renal artery and renal vein run along the junction of cortex and medulla and give branches to the glomerulus and receive branches from them respectively. The second, so that is the complete detail of the kidneys and their filtration unit, the uriniferous tubules, what is known as the nephrons. The second structure, which is part of the excretory system, are two thick walled tubules, which originates from the hilus of each kidney. They are known as ureters. They originate from the hilus, runs backward along the dorsal abdominal wall of rabbit, and opens posteriorly into the neck of urinary bladder, the collecting bag. So ureters are basically the tube which connects from the filtration structure, that is the kidney, to the collecting bag, that is the urinary bladder. Urinary bladder is a pear-shaped transparent muscular sac. It is situated in the pelvic region, ventral to the rectum, and connected to the ventral abdominal wall with the help of a suspensory ligament. It serves as a urine reservoir. Basically, the process of blood circulation and the process of filtration of blood, that is the process of excretion by the uriniferous tubules or nephrons, is a continuous process. It takes place 24/7 throughout the life of an animal. However, the urine removal from the body, which is known as micturition, does not take place 24/7 or regularly. The amount of urine which is generated also is not very large per minute or per second rate. So the smaller amount of the urine which is being generated, the filtrate, along with the waste products, they are temporarily collected in the urine reservoir, the urinary bladder. Once the urinary bladder is full with its capacity, it sends a signal through the nervous system, which creates a sensation of micturition or passing out urine to that individual animal, and then the animal urinate out occasionally, usually 2 to 3 times or 4 times, according to the amount of water intake and physical activities. The posterior narrow neck of the bladder, it bears a circular sphincter muscle, which is very much under the voluntary control of the individual animal. The posterior narrow neck of the bladder bears a circular sphincter muscle. The neck of the urinary bladder opens into a thick-walled muscular canal, that is the external canal through which the urine passes out to the exterior. That canal is known as urethra. The structure of urethra varies in male and female. In case of male rabbit, it is much longer and it passes through the penis and opens at the tip of the penis. In fact, in case of male, the same tube, urethra, serves two different functions. It is a part of excretory system where it serves as the excretory tube through which the urine is passed out to the exterior. It is also a part of reproductive system in which it is used to ejaculate semen to exterior. Hence, in case of male rabbit, the urethra is known as urinogenital canal. However, the structure and function of urethra is different in case of female. In case of female, the structure of urethra is short and it unites with the vagina, which is the reproductive canal, to form the vestibule, and both these tubular openings open together within a slit shaped vulva, that is the genital structure of the female. We'll discuss more about these structures during the reproductive system of rabbit. So this is the complete detail of the anatomy of excretory system of rabbit. In my next lecture, I'll discuss with you about the physiology or the process of excretion. Now, the resources which I have used in order to prepare this slide and material, I have used two different books. One of the book is Modern Textbook of Zoology, Vertebrates by R.L. Kotpal. And second book I have used is Chordate Zoology by P.S. Verma. All the images which I have used in this presentation are downloaded from Google Images. Thank you. And in order to see and understand the process or the physiology of excretion, please follow up my next lecture. Thank you.